Online worship, we are so grateful for you to be here. We are so grateful for God's presence to be here and among us wherever we may be. We want to worship Him this morning. We want to lift Him up and give Him praise. Come now, fount. Never cease to call for songs of love. morning you may feel like that God is not working, wherever you may be. Just defeat our sin, although that appreciation for the lyrics. Because those are vehicles to a greater thing. And that's the camera of God. We just want to worship. As we go to this next song, we will lift him up. We want to honor him with our gifts. Not only are we lifting up with our gifts of praise, we are laying ourselves on his altar, at his feet. Let's pray right now as you are led to give. That you would respond as he would lead you to give. And as we give that tithes and our offerings unto you.
Thank you.
where we are, but to the song that we just lifted up in worship. 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 says, there is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. We thank Heavenly Father for the perfect love that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to give a shout out to God. First of all, I just want to praise and praise the holy name of God. I've lifted up the holy name of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit is moving hard and fast in this place today, and I want to give a special shout out to our praise team this morning. I enjoy them every Sunday morning, and I enjoy every song that they lead us through in worship. But I'll be honest with you today. And in all sincerity, that may be the best I've ever heard them present. They don't perform, they present. And that may be the best I've ever heard them present that song. And I don't know if it's because they really meant it like they've never meant it before this morning or not, but the Holy Spirit is moving this place today. And I give God the praise and the glory and honor for it. What a blessing it is to be found in the house of the Lord today. I want to tell you how much I appreciate you as you listening in and you worship with us. And I just want to ask you if you could just say praise the Lord right where you are. It's okay. Raise your hand and glorify God and magnify the holy name of Jesus right now. That'd be great if you do that and give glory to God. This one, I was listening to the praise band. I was watching them, our three vocal folks. Scott sings as well, but I was thinking about our three vocal folks this morning. It reminded me a lot of them. Well, I just want to tell you, I thought about Peter, Paul, and Mary. Peter, Paul, and Mary, what a great job. But Peter, Paul, and Mary didn't have anything on our praise team this morning. In fact, if you want to do a trivia test this morning, you can put it on your screen now. You can just text it in or type it in and say, just name one song that Peter, Paul, and Mary recorded. And we'll give you extra credit for it. I don't know what you'll do with that extra credit, but we'll give you extra credit for it. I want to tell you how much I appreciate you as a listening congregation. I know that you're participating. I know that where you are, wherever you are, the Spirit of God is moving in you as well. And I thank you so very much. I want to go to the Lord in prayer in just a moment. But before we do that, I want to spend some time with you in the Word of God. I want to continue what we're doing now is continuing a series of services, about the Holy Spirit's movement at Pentecost, the birthday of the church. And today I want to talk about, in a particular subject I want to talk about, is that the early apostles, had a burden for Jesus Christ. They had a burden for lost souls, I should say. They had a burden for lost souls. We've been talking about different topics and the ingredients we find in the very first day of Pentecost, and wherever those ingredients are duplicated in the world today, you're still seeing revival of a Pentecostal portion. Some of those topics we talked about, some of those elements that were present on the first day of Pentecost was obviously the star of the show, which was they claimed the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. We talked about the fact that they were the apostles were in one accord. We talked about the fact that they were men of miracles. We talked about a number of topics, those are three in particular, but today we want to talk about the fact that they seem to have a burden for lost souls. With that in mind, I want to call your attention to the Word of God this morning. We'll be looking at several verses in Acts, the second chapter, beginning with verse 1. And I'll lead you through this process as we read together. Maybe you can read silently, or maybe out loud where you are, as I read here in the sanctuary. Listen carefully, though. This is the reading of God's holy, it is His inspired, His inerrant word. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, I want to call your attention to verse 38. As you look further down on the page, or maybe to the next page, Acts, the second chapter, and verse 38. Simon Peter has been preaching. He talked about one of the elements that was present, on the first day of Pentecost, was that Jesus preached a very, Simon Peter preached a very simple message, a gospel message. But he had a three-point sermon. He lifted up Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. This Jesus whom you have crucified, God's faith, Lord in Christ, you see. And so he began to preach this message about Jesus, three-point sermon, and 3,000 souls were saved. But in response to his lifting up Jesus Christ, we said there was an urgency on the part of the lost sinners, but also some good, godly, devout, religious people to get right with God, to get saved. And so they asked, there was a sense of urgency, we said, on the part of those the people who were listening on that day of Pentecost, at that congregation. And so they asked Simon Peter, what must we do? And Simon Peter replied, repent. Listen to this in verse 38. Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And now we drop down a couple more verses in verses 40 and 41. With many other words, he, that is Simon Peter, warned them, and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. And those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Would you take just a moment to bow your heads and close your eyes, and if you would you pray for me as I pray with you? Gracious God, I pray that you would hide me in the shadow of your cross so that these your people would hear your voice above mine, and so that they might discern the difference between the wisdom of God and the knowledge of a man. And Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, let them be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. For you alone, Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. I want to ask you to come, Holy Spirit, and have your way in us and through us and in spite of us today. Father God, I lift up those who are broken in body, broken in spirit, broken in relationships today. God, I pray for Pentecostal revival to take place in body, soul, and spirit today. Father God, I pray for those particularly on my heart and mind right now, me and those who may be dealing with this coronavirus. But I think about others today who seem to have been those that have been sort of kicked down the road, so to speak, pushed to the side. People that are suffering and dealing with things like cancer and heart disease, Lord. I lift them up to you right now, Father God. Help us not to forget those that are sick and afflicted. We pray for those who are walking in the twilight of time. We pray for those for whom it is our duty and our desire to pray, and for those that you place on our hearts right now. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you for answered prayers, for miracles that are happening at this very moment. And, Lord, we pray this prayer believing in the precious, the priceless, and the perfect name of Jesus, who is called the Christ. And let all God's people say, amen. Well, I want to spend some time with you back in the scripture today. We've been talking about happy birthday to us, and this is the eighth in a series of messages about Pentecost and about those elements that were present on the very first day of Pentecost, and that wherever these elements are being duplicated in the world today, you see that God is moving in a mighty, magnificent, marvelous way, and we see revival breaking out in Pentecostal proportions. Now, one of the things that we wanted to talk about today is there was a burden on the part of those apostles, those disciples of Pentecost. There was a burden on their part for lost souls. They had a burden for lost souls. When the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon them, they had a burden for lost souls. I can remember a day and time in the church when we continued to give invitations. I still do at the end of a worship service. But I remember one time going to the church, to a church And when I gave to the king at the end of the service, I gave an invitation to receive Jesus Christ for people to be saved from their sins. And I remember somebody at the attendant speaking to me at the end of the service and said, "We haven't had an invitation in this church in years." And I thought to myself, and even asked, "Well, what do you do then? What do you do at the end of the service? When you get to the end of the service, how do you close it out? When you get to the end of the service, what do you do?" You know, I don't understand it. What do you do when you don't give people to respond, if you're not going to give people an opportunity to respond to a salvation message, to receive Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life and the Savior of your soul? Then why did you come to begin with? Why did you come to worship to begin with? I mean, after all, isn't it all about Jesus? I've got to answer that question today. Do you have that burden for lost souls? You see, when the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon those apostles at Pentecost, they had a burden for lost souls, and you can see it in Simon Peter. When Simon Peter began to preach about Jesus Christ, he lifted up Jesus Christ, him crucified, buried, and risen again. 3,000 souls were saved because they asked him, "What must we do?" And he said, "Repent of your sins and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins." But I want you to notice something, that Simon Peter didn't just have a desire to see people come to Jesus Christ to be saved from their sins. In fact, he had a burden for lost souls. I want you to listen again to the scripture I read just a moment ago in verses 40 and 41, especially verse 40. There's a sense of urgency. There's a sense of urgency about it when Simon Peter gives that invitation. Listen again what he said. "With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, 'Save yourselves from this corrupt generation.'" Listen again. Can you hear that sense of urgency on the part of Simon Peter when he gives that invitation? "With many other words, he warned them." He warned them and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Simon Peter had a burden for lost souls. When the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon him, he had a burden for lost souls. I want to say to you today, I want to suggest to you today, that if you're a Christian, if you're a born-again Christian, if the fire of the Holy, if you've been born again by the Spirit of God, then you're going to have a burden for lost souls. And if you don't, I've got to ask you, then why not? Are you really a Christian? You see, Simon Peter had not always had that burden for lost souls. He didn't always have a hungering to share Christ so that people could respond and to be saved from their sins. In fact, he was just the opposite. Somebody once told me that Simon Peter's ministry could be evaluated in the light of three fires. First of all, there was a Simon Peter when he was under fire. Now you remember the night that Jesus Christ was betrayed, and he would later be crucified the next day. But you remember on that particular night, when Jesus was having the Last Supper, he said to Simon Peter, "Simon Peter, you'll deny that you even know me three times before the rooster crows." Simon Peter said, "It won't happen." But he did. You might remember when it came, the Bible tells us that Simon Peter, all the disciples fled, and that Simon Peter, he followed Jesus at a distance. Folks, I've got to share with you a thought with you today. That is the worst possible position you can be in. Not just to not follow Jesus, but to follow Jesus at a distance. Put space between you and Jesus. Put anything between you and Jesus. Space for anything else. To follow Jesus at a distance, because when you follow Jesus at a distance, when you're not hand in hand, face to face, walking with the Savior, when you're not having Jesus at a distance, then you fall prey to temptation. You fall into the trap of living like the rest of the world. We can't follow Jesus and follow him at a distance. Not really. Simon Peter, they had followed Jesus at a distance, and when he did, he felt it easy to deny that he even knew Jesus. So when Simon Peter was under fire, so to speak, people asked him three times, aren't you one of his apostles? Aren't you one of his disciples? Aren't you one of his followers? He said, I don't even know the man. Three times. And then there's Simon Peter by the fire. Now that happened after Jesus had been crucified, dead, buried, and risen from the dead. And when Jesus appeared to Simon Peter, he really reinstated Simon Peter. I'm convinced it was in John, the 21st chapter, we find that the apostles and Simon Peter was out, he was out fishing. And they saw Jesus on the seashore by the fire cooking fish. And Simon Peter jumped out of the boat into the water and swam all the way to the shore and to be with Jesus. And Jesus asked him, Simon Peter, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said, feed the sheep. Simon Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Then tend my lambs. Simon Peter, do you love me? Jesus said, do you love me? And Simon Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. Then feed my sheep. He gave Simon Peter an opportunity to once again to be reinstated. And Simon Peter reaffirmed his faith to Jesus Christ, Lord, you know I love you. Three times for every time he had denied Jesus. And one time for every time he lifted up the name of Jesus on the day of Pentecost. That was Simon Peter by the fire. The next time you're going to see Simon Peter, he's going to be at Pentecost. And when the fire of the Holy Ghost fell upon him, he was convinced, he was convicted, and he couldn't help but tell people about Jesus Christ, and he couldn't help but have a burden for lost souls. And he preached Jesus Christ, and he lifted up with such fire and such fervor that 3,000 souls were saved. 1,000 souls for every time that he had denied him. 1,000 souls every time that he said, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Simon Peter's ministry, his life with Jesus could be evaluated in the light of three fires. Simon Peter under fire. Simon Peter by the fire. Simon Peter on fire. Now, I want to ask you a question today. Do you have a fire in your heart? Do you have a burden for lost souls, winning people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ? You see, in the Methodist Church, in our Western tradition, we shouldn't have a problem with that. We shouldn't. That's why it was so astounding when I was asked that question. Why do you give an invitation? We don't give an invitation to this church. I thought, what do you do then? Why do you have church if you don't give an invitation for people to be saved as a sin and to come to know Jesus Christ as the Lord of their lives? Why bother? In the Wesleyan tradition, John Wesley said to his disciples, you have nothing to do but save souls. You have nothing to do but save souls. Spend it, and go to those not only who want you, but those who want you the best. Most, you have nothing to do but save souls. Do you have a hunger? Do you have a burden for lost souls? If not, why not? I'm convinced of this. There are only two kinds of churches full of two kinds of people. It's not a denominational thing. It's not Methodist or Baptist or Episcopalian or Presbyterian or Assembly of God or non-denominational. I'm convinced there are only two kinds of churches when it comes to evangelism and winning souls to Jesus Christ. There are churches who have a boat peak mentality, or another way of saying it, they have a boat peak mentality, or they have a good shepherd mentality. They have another way to say it is they have a century mentality, or they have a sin mentality. You know what I mean by that. You know that little nursery rhyme. Little Bo Peep has lost the sheep and doesn't know where to find them, but just leave them alone and they'll come home, wagging their tails behind them. And so we go out and we build these buildings, these marvelous buildings. We have a wonderful facility here at Epworth United Methodist Church. One day, bless God, God willing, we're going to be able to get it back into it and use it. But for right now, people just drive by it every day. They drive by it. But you know what? They were doing that before we had to close because of the pandemic. There were people driving by every day. And a lot of churches have that mindset. They have that mentality. They say, if we just put up a nice building with a high steeple and stained glass windows, then people will come by and they'll drive by the church and they'll look at the church and they'll say, you know, that's a nice church, a beautiful building. I need to go in and find Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and be saved from our sins. We think that people just drive by. As if, like, for example, you drove by McDonald's and all of a sudden you become a hamburger, or you drive by Kentucky Fried Chicken and you become a drumstick. We're crying out loud. It doesn't happen that way. People don't just, the lost sheep just don't come in because they pass by the church. But then again, there are churches who have not a Bo Peep mentality, but they have a Good Shepherd mentality. Because I read in a book one time, this some fellow by the name of Jesus said, even as the Father has sent me, so send I you. When he told a parable about it one time, there were 100 sheep in a flock, and one of them wandered off and got lost, and the Good Shepherd went out and he found the one that was lost. We are called to be a Good Shepherd church. Not a century church either. Not a century church, but rather a sent church. You know the story. It signified there was a place there in Europe where a traveler, a tourist, was coming by one day, and they noticed an unusual sight. There was a guard there, a sentry there, who was standing guard, a sentry who was standing guard, but he was standing guard on a barren piece of land. There wasn't anything around it for miles. And so the tourist asked that sentry, why are you standing guard over this particular piece of ground? The sentry said, I don't know. But he was curious. He asked the sergeant of the guard. The sergeant of the guard said, I don't know why. We just always done it. But he was curious as well. He asked the captain of the guard. The captain of the guard said, you know, I honestly don't know why we guard that particular piece of ground. We just always done it. Finally, the question went all the way up to the top, and they came back with the answer. And what had happened was, about 100 years before then, Catherine the Great had been moving through that area of Europe, and she had planted a rose bush in that particular piece of ground. And then she posted a guard, a sentry, to guard that rose bush in case any of the peasants or someone would want to pick the roses off that rose bush. Now, folks, that rose bush had been dead for almost 100 years, and nobody even knew why they existed. They didn't have a clue. And I have to tell you, sometimes in the church, if we're not careful, that happens to us. We become a century church, and we feel like our calling and our cause is to guard this holy piece of ground against all comers. Now, folks, I've got to tell you something. I'm not talking about we should stand up a doctrinal belief and biblical beliefs. You know me well enough to know that you know how strong I feel on certain things that are ethical matters based on the Bible, on the Word of God, about what is right and what is wrong. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm telling to you, there's more to life and ministry in the church, and there's more to what we're called to do than simply guard a holy piece of ground. But God has called us not to be sentries, but to have a sentry mentality. Not a sentry mentality, but rather a sent mentality. Because somebody said one time in the Bible, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. I've got to ask you a question today. Do you have a Bo Peep mentality or a Good Shepherd mentality? Do you have a sentry mentality or a sent mentality? I want to ask you a different way. How many people right now can you say that are in heaven? How many people do you know right now that are saved because you told them about Jesus Christ? That you witnessed to them about Jesus Christ? that you told them about the Jesus that's really real to you, that has come into your heart, that has changed your life, that has saved your soul, and therefore you know that you're going to spend eternity in heaven rather than hell. How many people do you know that have been saved through your testimony? Do you know anybody that doesn't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior? I got to ask you, what you waiting on? See, more people come to Jesus Christ because of the testimony or a friend, a relative, or a neighbor than to do preachers. That's a fact. I want to ask you, how many people do you know that's in the kingdom of heaven today because you told them about Jesus Christ? You see, we have nothing to do but save souls. Simon Peter, he didn't have a concern about that at all. He knew exactly what he had to do. He had a burden for lost souls. Do you have a burden for lost souls? Is that your passion? To win people to the saving and knowledge of Jesus Christ? If not, I've got to ask you, why not? And if I've got to ask you, if not now, when are you going to do that? You can't wait till it's too late. Let me pray with you for just a minute. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I just want to pray about a couple of things today, Lord. First of all, I want to ask you today to put a burden on our hearts for the lost. I pray that you put a burden on our heart for lost souls. I pray, Lord, that you would equip us and enable us and set us on fire for you, that we would tell people about the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. God, help us to stop majoring on the minor things. God, help us to put our heart into witnessing for Jesus Christ and forget all these things that people get so torn up about right now and worried about right now. God, help us to think on eternal things and eternal destiny for people that we know and love. God, give us a burden for lost souls in this church. Give us a burden for lost souls, beginning with me, Lord, beginning with me. Lord, I pray today also. I pray for those who might be lost today, for those who may be listening right now to this message, for those who will listen to this message later on. I pray that you would convict, Lord, to bring conviction, not condemnation, Lord, but conviction. Convince us of our sin and give us a burden to make things right between us and God by receiving Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord. God, I pray that right now that the prayer of every person's heart that's listening right now would be a simple childlike prayer of faith. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are God's Son. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose again that I might have eternal life. I believe, Lord, that you are the Son of God. And so, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart to be my Savior, to be my Lord. I pray that you would save me for eternity, that you save me from hell to heaven. I pray, Lord, today that you would save me from myself and my foolishness and my wicked ways. Lord Jesus, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. I pray that you give me the assurance of my salvation today. And God, give me a word for lost souls that I might share with others as Christ who has saved me. Lord Jesus, and I pray this believing in the precious, the perfect, and the powerful name of Jesus who is called the Christ. And let all God's people say, amen, amen. As we close our service today, I just want to encourage you, if you made that decision to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior today, feel free to email the church. I would love to hear from you. Feel free to share with somebody. In fact, I encourage you to, first of all, find a church home where the Word of God is being preached, the prayer of the Word of God is being preached. Get in the Bible, stay in the Bible, study and read the Bible every day, and get involved with another person who really knows Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life and the Savior of your soul, as a mentor, as you might grow together in the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that that God's Spirit will continue to move in you, that you will grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, I hope you have a great day. I pray that you keep your hand in Jesus' hand and your eyes on the cross. I hope you get a blessing from the song that we're going to sing in closing today. And the brother Scott is going to lead us in our closing prayer. Have a great day. God bless you.
As we close out our worship, lifting up and singing, how I love you.
I am lean.
Father, we just do love you right now, and we just state that, Father. We just praise you. We lift you up for loving us. Father, we just praise you because of who you are, the God that you are. Father, we just go at this time, Father, and we just ask that you would give us the courage to give an account for our life, Father, to give an account to others for what you have done in our life and in our heart. Father, we just love you so much, and we want to share that with others. Father, help us to be obedient where we are cautious, as Brother Grant has charged us today. Father, give us your courage to step out in faith and share the love that has made all the difference in our hearts and in our lives. We just love you. We lift you up, Father. We just ask, as the church scatters, Father, that they would go, that they would not only go, that they would go empowered to do your work. In the name of Jesus, we ask. Amen. Y'all have a great day. God bless.